So, the reason you play seven-game series in the playoffs is because in any given game, the better team doesn't necessarily win. In this game, in a vacuum by itself, the Avs were not the better team. Avs win 3-2 over the Vegas Golden Knights in overtime.
Oh my goodness gracious! Wasn't it time? Score! Justice is served!
Look, the scoreboard says 3-2. The Avs won the hockey game, and a lot of that is thanks to Philip Grubauer, who played fantastic, keeping the Avs in it for the vast majority of the game. Certainly everything beyond the first period, he was the superstar for the Avs. There was a lot of kind of weirdness in this game. The ice was clearly not very good. Players were falling down all over the place. Pucks were bouncing. A lot of weird stuff happening. Vegas ended up hitting two posts, and the Avs hit one of their own as well. So we're getting up there in the counts on both good and bad posts. Beyond that, there were a lot of penalties called in this game. 9 in total, and the Avs got the better of them. The Avs had 6 power play opportunities to Vegas's 3. We will get to some of those a little bit later on. In short, yeah, I do think the Avs got the better of the calls a little bit, but I also think they earned more calls, or rather, Vegas took more pretty blatant penalties. So, that is what it is. I'm perfectly okay with how this game was called. I know a lot of Vegas people are upset with the call in overtime, but you knock a stick out of a dude's hand, I do think that's a penalty. It's not like this came out of nowhere. Vegas got a power play with 3 minutes left in the game. They had their chance to end it. So let's talk about the first period, because the Avs were very good in the first period. I think they were the better team for that one period, and it did end up showing on the scoreboard. They're able to get on the board early off of a total meme. Vegas on the breakout here doesn't quite connect, and a puck just sails off through as the Avs regroup. Graves gets it over to Girard, and Girard makes a beautiful breakout pass here cleanly through the middle of the ice to spring Brandon Saad. Saad able to get away from Petrangelo just enough, basically a breakaway, and then meme tier fans on the puck, and somehow it opens Fleury's 5-hole and goes right through it. You take those. Look, Vegas's goaltending is in a little bit of trouble. Obviously, Leonard got bopped in Game 1, but in Game 2 here, yes, Fleury only gave up 3 goals, but he also only posted an .880 save percentage. It's not like the Avs were pummeling him with shots, so far, not so good in net for Vegas. Meanwhile, as I mentioned, Grubauer crushing it for the Avs. As the period would go on, the Avs would eventually take a penalty that would result in Vegas's first goal of the game coming on the power play. Don't have it on the clip here, but the Avs should be out of their zone. Ryan Graves failed to clear a puck on this one, which allowed Vegas to get reset up in the offensive zone on the power play, which eventually leads to this. The Avs kind of chasing just a little bit. They leave just enough room. Tough job for Belmar there. Hard to cover both sides of the seam. Gets picked right through him over to Martinez, and Martinez basically has an open net to throw the puck into. A symptom that caused the Avs trouble all game long. Their defense was not moving out pucks particularly well. Girard had a nice one on the Avs' first goal, but after that, he struggled. Graves struggled all night long, too. And then you have some of the usual suspects like Nemeth, who are also not moving pucks out particularly well. So, a big reason why the Avs ended up struggling in the second half of this game was because they just simply weren't getting pucks out controlled. That didn't creep up too much in the first period, though, outside of that goal. The Avs continue to put pressure on offensively. They eventually draw their second, third, and fourth power plays of the period, which they only managed to capitalize on one, but all they needed was to capitalize on one to end the period with a lead. Andre Burakovsky on the break-in for the power play, and he actually makes it work with a nice little pass to Jost up the wall. Jost then walks in, gets it in deep. The Avs are now set up. This is where you want to be with your power play. You haven't seen enough of it from the second unit, but they get it here. Taves walking the blue line, finds Girard, and then Girard walks in. Come on. Everybody knows he's not going to shoot this puck, right? But Jost very nicely worked out up high in front of the man in the middle for Vegas, giving himself an opportunity. He's strong on his skates and stick here to get this shot off and beats Fleury beautifully. It has been a while since the second unit scored a goal. I cannot remember the last time they did. I'm assuming they probably scored one somewhere in the St. Louis series, but off the top of my head, I cannot remember. So that is a big boost to the Avs, and you're starting to see how the Avs forward core is shaping up. That second, third line, whatever you want to call it, of Jost, Nichushkin, and Saad did a lot of the heavy lifting for the Avs tonight. The top unit, three-headed monster, was fine for most of the night. Not great, not awful. It was a little all over the place. But the second line, would third line, they're interchangeable, honestly, at this point. But the Burakovsky, Donskoy, and Compher line, not good tonight at all. And the fourth line kind of got caved in as well. So the Avs were kind of running with two effective lines for most of this game. The Avs ended the first period with 11 shots. They would only have 12 through the second and third periods combined. It just got pretty rough for Colorado through the rest of the game. Vegas gave them everything they had. They were completely all over them, just hyper-aggressive on the puck, constantly smothering them, and it worked pretty darn well for them. They ended up dominating not just puck possession, but zone time. As I mentioned, the Avs really struggled to get the puck out of their own zone, not just cleanly, but at all. Pretty much the entire second period felt like they were just weathering the storm, and eventually Vegas found the tying goal. So the puck's in the Avs zone here, and they're back normally covering. Everything is fine, but then we get into this weird situation where the Avs are exiting the zone, and Graves jumps up into the play, while Girard is kind of back in behind. But Graves slows down, checks behind him, goes over here. As the puck goes out of the zone, the Avs lose control of it, and Vegas gets back in quickly. Now, all of a sudden, Graves has to turn around and try and get back in this play, but he can't really do a ton, and there's this crossover here of somehow Girard and Graves ended up on the same side of the ice. I don't know whose fault this was. I'm not sure how the Avs are set up, which defenseman was supposed to cover this near side here, but someone clearly missed their assignment, and that turnover cost them massively. I'm assuming it was Graves, but maybe Graves was expecting Girard to stay on this near side as he was joining the rush. I don't know. Either way, that's bad. You can't give a breakaway to Riley Smith, who finishes on the backhand over Grubauer. Even after the game was tied, Colorado struggled to find their footing. Vegas just kept coming at them well into the third period as well. There were a couple of chances here and there where it looked like the Avs could be dangerous on the counterattack, but it was just that, the counterattack. There was very little sustained zone time for the Avs. The third period was just the Philip Grubauer show. He absolutely would not allow the Avs to fall behind in this hockey game, and that's the only reason the Avs were able to come out of this one unscathed, cleanly. Grubauer played fantastic. I've already praised him a couple of times in this video, but he deserves every ounce of it. The Avs are probably looking at a 1-1 series with anyone else in net. So Avs fans have been making diamonds for about 30 minutes of hockey at this point, but they get into overtime as the Avs kill off the extremely late power play. Don't have a problem with that call. I think it's a penalty, but it comes super late in the game. When you compare it around the league, people's thoughts about the playoffs, you see that go uncalled pretty regularly. Not complaining. Like I said, I'm perfectly happy with the call. Just saying, the way this game was called, they were calling things pretty regularly. They were calling things that you don't see get called a lot in the playoffs. Which leads me to the overtime call. Look, Mikko got the stick slashed out of his hands. That's a penalty. It's a penalty. I don't know what to tell you. The Avs go on the power play less than a minute into the OT, and the top unit, the top line that had been a little bit up and down, comes through when they are needed most. OT power play, Mikko is collecting the puck in the corner here, gets it up to Kale McCarr, and then they play pitch and catch along the boards here for a little bit, but look at how patient Mikko is. This is a pressure situation, and he gets two Vegas players to drag to him before making this pass to the middle to Donskoy, who works it out up high, but all of a sudden, two players dragged all the way to the side of the ice here. It just creates so much room on the ice. The Avs work it across to McKinnon. McKinnon does his thing with the puck for a little while. And you see, Vegas kind of gets backed off a little bit here. Donskoy in the middle. Nicholas Waugh decides he wants to cross-check him right in the back. But, yeah, That was a decision to make because all of a sudden this is a pretty easy passing lane for McKinnon to hit Mikko. Mikko doesn't one-time it. He goes vintage instead. He scored plenty of goals this way. He has the room to walk all the way into the dot, get that wrister going, ticks off of Fleury here. It's a great shot. It goes off the shoulder, doesn't quite get enough of it, and it's in. On the live watch, pretty much sums this one up, so I'll play that and leave it there.
Yes! Mikko! Let's go!
Look, the Avs were not the better team, at least on the underlyings, at least in that way, during this game. But they were the better team on the scoreboard, and that's the only thing that matters. They go up 2-0 in the series, which is ridiculously huge. The difference between it being an even series going into Vegas and 2-0 means the Avs are perfectly happy if they split in Vegas. That puts them one win away from closing the deal. Instead of having to go in it being necessary to win one just to keep the series even. You have to feel confident right now if you're the Avs. This was very far from their best hockey, and they still at worst kept up with Vegas and managed to pull it out. No doubt Vegas is going to come out strong, if not even stronger, if they have anything left to give at home. So no freebies. You don't get to take the rest of this series off. The Avs have to keep working, to go back to the film room and make adjustments to clean up their breakouts. There's no doubt about it. But right now, the Avs are 6-0 in the playoffs. They just look like they've found a way to do what they have to. Even when they're off, they get it done. Nothing but good vibes right now. That is the end of this game video review. Thank you for watching. Head on over to thednvr.com for more playoff coverage. I am Rudo, and boy, that game was exhausting.
Lunch time, come on, grab your friends. We're going to the playoffs again. With Nate the dog and Gabe the babe. The fun isn't over yet. It is Avalanche time.